We've had a tremendous week focused on interesting and challenging conversations on the impact of COVID-19 across all sectors of the global economy and healthcare. But we must acknowledge the devastating cost in human lives of this virus. With over 120,000 deaths in the US alone, where communities impacted by structural and racial inequalities are hardest hit. And now almost 500,000 have died globally. We cannot take our foot off the brake as we continue to see emerging hotspots across the country and around the world. And what better way to close this week than with a discussion featuring leaders at the center of the race to a cure? What is top of mind for all of us is when will things go back to normal? And what do we need in either a treatment or vaccine to return us to that new normal? And how do we keep safe in the meantime? We are thrilled to have Dr. Tony Fauci, Director of the National Institutes of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, and Dr. Albert Bourla, Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of Pfizer, who are working on this issue around the clock. Our discussions with Dr. Fauci was pre-recorded as his schedule, very busy schedule, has changed. At Faster Cures, we've been focused on accelerating the development of either a treatment or vaccine for COVID-19 and providing clear and consistent information on the nearly 250 treatment compounds and 170 vaccine candidates in either preclinical or clinical testing, a pipeline that is truly a reason for hope. This tracker, which is updated daily, can be found on the milkeninstitute.org website. We've also interacted with dozens of biotech companies and researchers across the country and all over the world, working in search of a cure. Today's discussions will help us better understand how we are pushing aggressively toward a cure while adhering to sound science and smart public health protocols. With that as our backdrop, let's get started. We will begin with the interview between Dr. Fauci and Meg Terrell of CNBC recorded earlier today, and then we will hear from Dr. Albert Bourla of Pfizer. Thank you.
Well, hi, Dr. Fauci. It's great to see you.
Good to see you, Meg.
Well, let's start with where we are in the country right now, these record numbers of new daily infections. How do you reflect on the status of the epidemic in the U.S.?
You cannot deny this is a serious situation, a serious turnaround right now. We have a big country. It's heterogeneous. There are certain parts of the country that are doing really well, that have been hit, have come down, are maintaining the suppression of the virus, are in a very prudent way, doing a stepwise fashion to reopening. But there are other parts of the country that I'm very concerned about. And everybody knows now because it's been so widely publicized, you know, Florida, California, Arizona, Texas, places like that. There really is a difficult situation because as individual states, cities, locations are opening up, they're really seeing a serious concern of increase in cases. And it isn't just because they're doing more testing. There are more cases, there are more hospitalizations in some of those places, and soon you'll be seeing more deaths. And even though the deaths are coming down as a country, that doesn't mean that you're not going to start seeing them coming up now. Now, it's very interesting, the demography of the people that are getting infected are generally young individuals, much more so than early on what we saw in New York and what we saw in New Orleans. There's always been young people, but right now it's dominated by young people. Now, that's going to mean that they themselves may not necessarily get hospitalized as much as if an older person or someone with an underlying condition. But sooner or later, if the chain is not interrupted, they will infect individuals who are vulnerable, who will require hospitalization. And there'll be a lag. It may take a few weeks, but we'll see that. And that's my concern. Mm.
To what do you attribute, you know, the spread that we're seeing? Is it that areas of the country opened too soon? Or, you know, were there ways to open at the time these places opened, but, you know, we just didn't do it in the right way?
You know, it's a combination of all of the above, I must say. It is not some sort of, you know, unidimensional way to describe it. It's multiple. It's what you said. First of all, many of those states, when we locked down months ago, they had never yet gotten to the point where the potential of the outbreak was even met because they locked down early, which was good. Now we have a situation where a couple of things are going on. Either they're jumping over the checkpoints. They're not doing it in as prudent a way. I think that's less of a problem because I've spoken to the governors and some of the mayors. So they're not just being reckless about it, but what's happening, and this is something that is very, very difficult to get your arms around, is that the people who've been pent up in those places, they're looking at it as an all or none phenomena. Either we're locked down or let's storm the bars, go to the beach, no masks. That's what the problem is. Because if you're going to open up, as I've said countless times, even with you in previous interviews, that if you're going to open up, you've got to do it in a stepwise, prudent fashion. If you go from lockdown to complete caution to the wind, you're going to get into trouble.
Well, what is the solution now for these areas that are in such trouble? We saw in Texas, they are pausing the state's reopening, basically freezing it where it is, and in the hospitals, not allowing elective surgeries to try to make space for potential COVID patients. But do areas that are seeing the worst spread need to consider going backwards even more and perhaps going back into shelter-in-place orders?
They may have to do that. I think if you immediately say, go, in other words, these all or none phenomenon that just mislead us. If you say you're going to go back into lockdown, there'll be an absolute pushback on that. You might have to do it. You never take that off the table. But before you do that, how about doing the things that we said all along you should do? For goodness sakes, avoid crowds. Wear masks. Those are the fundamentals that when you look at the television clips, when you see pictures in the print newspapers, people are not doing that. That's a recipe for disaster. So we've already proven the point. I mean, if somebody had any doubt that when you do things like getting involved in a crowd, coming out, not wearing a mask, that there are no consequences to it, I need say no more. Look at what's going on.
Is telling people now to wear masks in areas like Arizona and Texas going to be enough to stop the increase we're seeing there?
Well, it's not going to stop it cold, but it certainly could slow it down and prevent further. Now, the trouble is, when you've left the genie out of the bottle and there's now infections in the community, that's a problem. And the problem is that we know now for sure that there are a significant proportion of people are asymptomatic, and they can spread without even knowing it. To do contact tracing and isolation, when you have a situation in which there are so many people who are asymptomatic, that makes that much more difficult, which was the reason why you wanted to get it from the beginning and nip it in the bud. Once you get what they call the logarithmic increase, then it becomes very difficult to do contact tracing.
Well, how would you assess the status of trying to build up those armies of contact tracers across the United States? We hear some reports from different localities that they just don't have enough people, or people don't answer their phones or share information. How is this going in the U.S.?
It's not going well. I have to tell you, it's not going well. There are some places where it's going very well. But in order, when you have an outbreak, an outbreak, you can't just sequester and things. Whenever you have this smoldering and sometimes flaring up, it endangers everything because as long as that's going on, people are going to travel, people are going to move around, and they're going to be seeding in other places. So what we need to do is we need to rethink, and we are right now, that the idea of many more tests getting into the community and even pooling tests. And pooling tests means, I think some people understand that, but if they don't, it's simple. Instead of I test me and I test you. So I've now occupied two tests, but I only know what two people have. Whereas if you take 20, 30, 40, pull them, do one test. If they're all negative, then you know that that's negative. You now have 40 people who are negative. If you get a positive, then you backtrack and try and figure out who that positive is. We really need to start doing that because the idea about doing individual identification, isolation, contact tracing, particularly in some communities where people don't want to cooperate. They don't want to tell you where they've been and who they've been with. I mean, you think it's a natural situation where people will say, oh, of course, I'll cooperate. But there's such a pushback on authority, on government, on all kinds of things like that. It makes it very complicated.
Mm. That pooling test idea is very interesting. How would that be coordinated? Who would be doing it?
No, I mean, the same people who do the other. The CDC is trying to enact that now. Get people who know about that into the community. It's not a big switch to do that. It's not terribly different.
I want to ask you also about some comments we heard from Dr. Redfield yesterday on the CDC briefing. He said that the CDC's serology surveillance, so checking for antibodies, shows that maybe 10 times as many people in the U.S. have been infected than we've identified. Is that good news in that there are 10 times as many people who might now be immune? Or is it bad news in that 10 times as many people right now are spreading the virus and we don't know?
Well, I would call it sobering news. You know, it's bad if you don't handle it properly. It's certainly not good news. I mean, no way is it good news when you think there are 10 times more people infected than you thought there were. So I think that's something that we need to address, which gets to what I was saying of things that I brought up actually months ago to consider start literally flooding the system with testing. So you really get a good handle about what is going on in the community.
Mm-hmm. And do you see us on the verge of flooding the system with testing? I mean, are we about to see that happen, or will there be delays in getting that implemented?
I don't know if there's going to be delays, but you can be sure I'm telling you this and I'm being very vocal about it. I think we need to do that.
I want to ask you also a little bit more about the idea that younger people are making up a bigger proportion of those getting infected. You touched on it. Dr. Redfield yesterday was kind of discussing it in a way that it sounded like it was a positive development. He was saying we're in a different situation than we were in March and April, when it was older and more susceptible people being diagnosed because they were in the hospitals and that was where the testing was. But what does this really mean for our country? A lot of people say, oh, the death rate is coming down. We might see a lag of a few weeks. Is it good news? I mean, that more young people are making up a bigger bulk.
Yeah. See, I don't want to make a comment about what another person said. It'll get, Meg, we've been there before. It's going to get distorted. I cannot see anybody getting infected being good news. Okay. I mean, how do you call that good news? So
that makes sense. Is there anything you think about the fact that the deaths are coming down that's anything other than just a lag? Does it reflect possibly better treatment, either a better understanding of the disease or remdesivir or dexamethasone?
Both. Certainly we know how to treat people better, definitely. But remember, deaths lag behind hospitalizations that lag behind individuals getting sick, that lag behind people getting infected. So if you get infected, sick, hospital, death. If you get infected here, you're not going to see deaths until weeks down.
Right.
Maybe less, because the people who are getting infected are young, provided that they don't then infect the susceptible people. Because when they do that, you're going to wind up having more hospitalizations and more deaths. Mm-hmm. A young, otherwise healthy person has a less of a likelihood. You look at the charts, the bar graphs, hospitalizations, children, adolescents, young adults, then you get up to the 85-year-old, they occupy much, much more with people with underlying conditions. However, if the young people who are infected and don't know they're infected, those 10-to-1 ratio that Dr. Redfield correctly talks about, they may be inadvertently infecting the people who are susceptible to greater complications. Then you start seeing greater hospitalizations and deaths.
Mm-hmm. How would you assess the data we've seen so far coming in about the protests and whether that's contributed to spread? California does cite perhaps some contribution from the protests and their spread, whereas Massachusetts doesn't see evidence of that. And of course, very different situations in those two states, but how do you look at it?
Yeah. You know, you really can't pinpoint it. You have to make a reasonable assumption that when you have crowds, congregation of people, many of whom are not wearing masks, some of whom are pulling their masks down, if you have multiple factors contributing to the increase in cases, someone will always argue and say, well, you can't prove that it was because of a demonstration. But I think you can make a reasonable assumption that when people congregate, particularly without masks, pull their masks off and start chanting or shouting or screaming, that you are definitely increasing the risk. That I can tell you for sure. The risk of acquisition or transmission increases. Is there definitive proof that they play a major role in the increase? No, you can't do that because you have multiple factors going on at the same time. So somebody could always argue that that's not contributing. But the fact is, there's a really good chance that it is.
Mm-hmm. How do you look at the seasonality factor of this virus? There was sort of maybe a hope that we might get some reprieve this summer because of the seasonality factor. However, that could be very concerning for the fall. We don't see that trough yet this summer, but does that still not mean that we might, you know, not see an increase in the fall?
Well, I think they may be completely unrelated. I mean, you know, your question is, it's true, but unrelated. So, you know, yes, we are not seeing a sharp decrease. Look at the numbers. And it's pretty hot down in Florida right now. It's pretty hot in Southern California. It's pretty hot in Texas. And they're having a surge. So warm weather still may have an important positive impact, but it's getting drowned out in all the other things that are making it go up. So if you have, you know, the kind of exposure that people are putting themselves to superimposed upon the warm weather may be driving it down. This is driving it up and you have no idea where you are. But the one thing is for sure, the warm weather we're seeing now is not curtailing any outbreak. So again, we get to that situation about the wave in the fall. And I keep saying, I'm not trying to be facetious, we are knee deep in the first wave. We can't be talking about the second wave because let's get out of the first wave first. But if, and I hope it's soon, you start to see cases go down as we get into July and August, since the virus is not gonna disappear. I mean, it's not gonna just go away. It'll be around. It's too efficient in its transmissibility to be able to just disappear the way SARS did. So when the fall comes, we better be ready that there will be surges of cases. And as I've said so many times now for months, we have a few months to prepare for that. So when that happens, we have to be able to do the proper and effective way of identification, isolation, and contact tracing. Not checking the box that you did it, but actually do it. Get people on the ground, not on the phone. When you identify somebody, have a place to put them to get them out of social interaction. To just say you're gonna go out and identify, contact, trace, and isolate, well, that doesn't mean anything until you do it.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that localities just need more funding? I mean, what's holding the contact tracing efforts back, you know, that we can control? I mean, there's some level of, you know, suspicion of people getting calls from the government asking them where they've been, but the things that we can control, what right. could help?
You know, that is a complicated issue, Meg, and I'll tell you why. Because as you probably remember, a short time ago, billions of dollars that were given to the CDC to distribute to the states for the purpose of identification, isolation, contact tracing. And that meant do whatever you need to do to get it done. You need to build a hotel to put people in there, do it. Just do what you need to be done. We got to make sure that happens because I don't really see that happening to a great degree right now. So we better get on it and make it happen.
Why do you think it's not happening?
You know, I think because it's not an easy thing to do. I mean, I want to be fair, and we should be, because they're going through difficult times, to the state. Some are doing it right now and doing it well. Others need to get their plan more sharpened to get it done.
Mm. Who do you see doing it well?
I'm not going to do that.
Okay. I asked the good question, not the bad question, at least. I want to ask you also about the 14-day quarantine travel advisory that the tri-state area here has put in place. Is that a good thing to try to keep cases down here?
You know, Meg, I'm not gonna say good, bad. I'm gonna say that it's understandable why they're doing that. I think when you have, I don't know if I can agree or disagree, but I clearly can understand the reason for that. And that is those areas have suffered terribly, terribly. At a time when the New York metropolitan area and the tri-state area were getting hit, they got hit worse than any place literally in the world, practically. So the idea of, after all that work, getting it down now to which I think they're in phase two, thinking about going into phase three, they don't want to see a turnaround about that. So I can understand why they're doing it. Whether or not it's going to turn out to be feasible, I don't think so, because if everybody starts excluding everybody else, you're going to have a very interesting situation in this country.
Yeah. Well, I want to ask you also about vaccines. How are you trying to set the public's expectations for what a vaccine will actually do for us, in terms of how well it'll work, when a vaccine will be widely available to people, not just when the first ones will be available, but when widely available, and if it'll actually mean we can really go back to normal life?
Well, if you get a vaccine that is, let's say, 70, 75% effective, and we widely distribute it, which I think is feasible, you know, as I've said, the timetable, there's no guarantees with vaccines. I've told you that in previous interviews, but we feel cautiously optimistic that we will have one that will be effective. How effective it is going to be very important in determining how quickly you can get back to, quote, normal, as you say. If you get one that's really effective, 75, 80% effective, which would be really good, that would really confer enough immunity into society that you could start thinking about that together with public health measures. The one thing we better be careful of, we can't think that when you get a vaccine, you could throw all caution to the wind. You got to do both. And I would imagine that if things work out well, you know, without any speed bumps or potholes that we don't know about, that by the end of this year, the beginning of 2021, that we should have a vaccine. Again, with no guarantee, but if we're going to get one, it likely will be available by then.
And available widely to anybody who wants to get it?
You know, the companies tell us, and we keep asking, are you sure? And they say yes, that they, by the beginning of the year, could have hundreds of millions of doses, and by the end of the year, even as much as a billion doses. That's what they tell us. You know, that's pretty impressive if they can do it, but they keep saying they can. More than one company. So it isn't just one outlier company saying they're going to do that. Several of the companies say that within a reasonable period of time, they will have hundreds of millions of doses.
Mm. And when you cite that, you know, 75 to 80% effective, does that mean in preventing infection, preventing the disease, preventing severe disease?
Good. Well, that's a great question, because there are some vaccines that prevent initial infection. So that is called sterilizing immunity. Many vaccines don't prevent infection, but they prevent you from getting sick. So that if you get infected, you may have either no symptoms or mild symptoms. But when you do a lab test, you find out that you actually have gotten infected and didn't even know it. Influenza acts that way. Influenza vaccines, most of the time, you judge it by how it prevents you from getting sick enough to require attention of a physician. So if I get the flu vaccine, I get exposed and I get infected, but I don't really feel very badly, maybe a little sniffle, then that worked on me. That worked because it prevented me from getting sick.
So we're, from the timelines we've been hearing from companies and from the Operation Warp Speed communications, we're only a couple weeks away from starting the first phase three trial in the US.
Correct.
Tell us how that's shaping up. What's the latest?
No, the latest is that it seems to be on schedule, probably sometime in July. Don't know whether it's gonna be the second week or the third week, but you know, that's the candidate that we did the phase one trial on. It's fully enrolled. The data look good. It's inducing the kind of response that you would hope it would do. When you go into a phase three, you know, you have two doses, you have a prime and a boost. So it's gonna take 28 days to get any individual person vaccinated. And you don't vaccinate, I mean, the trial is geared to enroll 30,000 people. So you're not gonna enroll 30,000 people on the first week. It's going to take weeks and months to get them all enrolled. So you figure you start in July, get the second dose in August. By the time you get everybody enrolled, it's the early fall. Then if there are cases around, you wish there wouldn't be, but there likely will be, either here or in other countries, you determine if it's effective. So somewhere in the mid to late fall, early winter, we'll know if it's effective.
How long do you feel is needed to ensure safety of a vaccine in the phase three trials? And have you seen any evidence in the early data or animal models of the idea of antibody-dependent enhancement, that the vaccine could actually make the infection worse?
No, that's something we obviously are keenly aware of. And that's the major thing we're focusing on when you're looking for safety. So far, the animal model doesn't give any indication that that's occurring. But you got to be careful because animal models can sometimes mislead you. So the proof of the pudding is looking carefully as you get into the trial for this phenomenon. You know, usually people think of phase three trials as less safety, more efficacy. But we're putting a very keen eye on the possibility of there being enhancement during the phase three study.
And how long do you need to sort of be sure about that before you roll it out?
You know, it isn't long. It's quantity of people. So, I mean, if you have 20,000 people or 15,000 people, it doesn't matter. I mean, if you do that in a week, it takes a week. If you do it in 6 months, it'll take 6 months. So antibody enhancement, so that people understand what we're talking about, Meg, it means that you get an immune response that's suboptimal. It doesn't protect you, but the antibodies that are made bind to the virus when you get infected. And instead of neutralizing it, it kind of allows it to enter the cell more easily and actually enhances the infection instead of diminishing it. It's a very rare event. We don't think it's going to occur, but it would be I think imprudent for us not to carefully look for it.
Well, we've also seen lots of data showing that COVID-19 affects minority communities much worse than others. Are there efforts to specifically make sure that the most vulnerable populations are included in these trials?
Well, the answer is yes. And funny you should ask, because I was on the phone last night until midnight, and this morning at around 5:30, talking with the people who are involved in that about making sure that we actually do that.
It presents a bigger challenge?
Well, it is a bigger challenge because, you know, I think you and I may have discussed this some time ago. There is, in the community, this anti-science, anti-vax kind of attitude among some people. So we've got to try and convince people who have a suspicion of authority, and to them, people who are trying to vaccinate them are authority, to let them know that this is for the good of the public health, their own personal health, as well as the health of the community. You've got to reach out to the community. You've got to reach out to the right people. You've got to go into the communities, particularly those who have skepticism about vaccines, and get the community people to help you to convince them of the importance of getting vaccinated.
And thinking about how these vaccines will get approved, do you anticipate they will be approved based on how well they prevent infection or disease? Or, you know, there's some concern that the FDA could approve the vaccines based on just the antibody data alone.
Yeah. Well, I have been consistently vocal about this, and I'll say it to you so that when we come back in another interview, we could talk about it. And that is, I really want to make sure that we don't have a vaccine that's distributed among the American people unless we know it's safe and we know it is effective. Not that we think it might be effective, but that we know it's effective. And that means you get an efficacy signal based on its ability to prevent infection or disease.
I know you've got to go. I've got two questions for you on drugs really quickly. Dexamethasone, pretty remarkable results from the recovery trial in the UK. Is that now being added to the protocol as standard of care for NIH-run studies?
Well, yes, actually, you're aware, because I think we spoke about it, that the NIH has been responsible for organizing and putting together a guidelines panel That's a group that meets in real time. It produces a living document online. It's coronavirusguidelines.gov, and if you click into that, it in real time updates guidelines. And just yesterday, actually, interesting, the panel looked at the data and has now made that part of the guidelines of care for people with advanced disease on a ventilator.
Other question about drugs in development, antibody drugs for COVID-19, new drugs being developed. There were some papers in Science suggesting that cocktails are needed to avoid the virus basically getting around the drug, similarly to what we saw in the early days of HIV. How do you look at that?
Oh, I think that's perfectly appropriate, that whenever you have either a drug or even an antibody, you've got to anticipate that the virus is smart enough that what it's going to do, it's going to try and evade what you're doing. And the more roadblocks you give it, the much more difficult it is for it to evade you. So you start off with one antibody, and then if that's safe and looks good, then you do a couple more. So there are going to be combinations of antibodies. Monoclonal antibodies, it's relatively easy to do that.
We're out of time. Any advice you want to leave the country with right now?
No, I think it's clear now what's going on, that we need to take this seriously. When you see mostly young people, I totally understand the desire and the urge, since you've been locked down so long, to go out and just let it rip, as they say. Just go out and have a great time. You've got to understand that, A, we're seeing more and more situations where young, otherwise healthy people who get infected are getting seriously ill. So you have a responsibility to yourself. But as important is that when you get infected, even if you don't have any symptoms, you are part of the dynamic process of propagating a pandemic that's killing people. So just think about that for a second. You may say, well, you know, I get infected, so what? But particularly if you're inadvertently and you don't know you're infected, you could infect someone who would infect someone who then infects someone's grandfather who's old and sick, grandmother, cousin who has breast cancer and on chemotherapy, a child who has leukemia and is on chemotherapy. You're not in a vacuum. You're part of a process. So please try and understand that societal responsibility.
All right. A good message to end on. Dr. Fauci, thanks for being with us.
Good to be with you.
All right. Well, hello again, everybody. Very excited to get to be talking today with Albert Bourla, the CEO of Pfizer. Pfizer, of course, one of the companies that Dr. Fauci was talking about in terms of developing a vaccine, also working on medicines for COVID-19. Albert, it's great to see you.
Great to see you, Meg, again. And I'm looking forward to our discussion.
Well, me as well. Let's start right on that vaccine question, because Dr. Fauci was talking about how this is a tall order, what you and other companies in the industry are working on. The timelines we're talking about for vaccine development have never been accomplished before on a new pathogen. By the end of the year or early next year, for widespread availability of the vaccine, is that timeline lining up with what you're seeing internally at Pfizer?
You're right, and I'm very proud for the way that the pharmaceutical industry has reacted to that. And there are multiple efforts right now that are trying to bring a vaccine that's safe and efficacious. And of course, not only to bring it all the way to an approval by the appropriate authorities, FDA or EMA, but also to be able to make it available in the significant volumes that will be needed. And I know that many companies are trying right now, and I wish that they will all be successful. Because we will need multiple options and we need a lot of volume. As regards our efforts and our vaccines, I have spoken earlier that we are working on a manufacturing schedule that if the vaccine is, let me put it from development and discovery. We believe that we will have data about the safety and the efficacy of a large trial like the one that Dr. Fauci just spoke of 30,000 people. We believe that we could have data that could convince us that we have a vaccine that it is safe and efficacious in the September timeframe. And if that's the case, and we are lacking, we could then discuss with FDA, and we could have a potential approval in the October timeframe.
Mm. Now, wow.
If those are moving according to the plan, and as I start, you need to have the stars aligned to accomplish what I'm just describing to you. And frankly, I'm still surprised that things are still aligned. So we are moving towards timelines. If that's the case, we will have quantities available in October. And we do that by manufacturing, of course, at risk. It will be fewer the doses that we will have in October, will be more the doses that we'll have in November, and will be even more the doses that we'll have in December. But as I had spoke before, we were expecting to have in 2020, before the end of the year, tens of millions, and next year, hundreds of millions. I'm a little bit more optimistic now. I think we can go all the way to 100 millions this year and all the way to 1 billion next year. But of course, as also Dr. Fauci pointed out, and as I want everyone to understand, if we are lucky and the product works and we do not have significant bumps on our way to manufacturing.
Yeah, wow. So by September, safety and efficacy data in the large trials. Right now, we haven't even seen the first human data on your vaccine approach. Before I ask you that question, let's take a step back and explain to the audience, if they're not, you know, laser focused on the vaccine race, what the technology is that Pfizer is employing. What are you guys doing here on the vaccine?
Yeah, there are multiple technologies that are employed right now. And I think also that's a very good thing because there are multiple platforms out there. The enemy is not the other companies. The enemy is the virus and time. That's the only enemy that we have right now. We are using a technology that is called mRNA. And it is a technology that we are working together with a German biotech, which is called BioNTech, in this technology 2 years now. Our initial idea was to develop a flu vaccine. And we were working on that. Once the pandemic was declared and we realized the need for a vaccine, we thought that we investigated all the platforms that we had available, and we had the adenovirus, we had multiple vaccine platforms, and we felt that that would be the most appropriate for several reasons. One, it is the technology that can very quickly replicate results, or you can very quickly move from the identification of the virus all the way to production. Things that you need with other maybe to do in months, you can do that in weeks. Very important in terms of that the virus mutates, because then you would need to change your vaccine, that you can do it very quickly. Influenza is a virus that quickly mutates. That's why we wanted to do this technology with influenza. But also, this technology allows you to boost what Dr. Fauci was saying, that you can vaccinate twice, so that will provide significant enhanced immune response according to the theory. Of course, it needs to be proven on the trials. So this is where we are. As you said, you haven't seen data from us yet. And we have a strict policy at Pfizer that we want to present, to announce, let's say, if we're good or bad, or if we have good results, only after we put out there a paper for publication. So this is the reason why you haven't heard from us, but you will, of course, when you are ready with the publication. This will be the time that we will put all the data out, and then we will also discuss about them.
Can you give us a sense of the time frame when you're expecting to have the paper be published? And that would be the first we would see of the human data when the scientific paper is published?
Yes, we have a lot of data, Meg. We have data in animals, we have data in mouse and primates, which are very important, monkeys, and we have data in humans. And we plan, as we are concluding chunks of the studies, to put them out there. So I don't want to be specific when that will be, but I don't think it will take long, because most of the data are already in-house. So I have seen them, for example. We just need to make sure that we write the papers in a way that magazines can, they are fitting the scientific format of scientific publication.
Based on what you've seen, does your optimism level match Dr. Fauci's?
Yes, I'm cautiously optimistic as well, as he used the same expression. Let me put it this way. When we started this effort, the basic question in my mind was if we are going to have a vaccine. After everything I have seen, I'm much more into when we are going to have a vaccine rather than if. Of course, nothing. The beauty with science is that you don't have to, you don't need to have faith. Data speak for themselves, right? So based on the data that I have seen, I'm cautiously optimistic that we will achieve what Dr. Fauci and others have spoken, which is we go in a big trial, we vaccinate thousands of people with our vaccine, and then we vaccinate equal amount of people with a placebo, not a vaccine, water, let's say. And then you let those people live their lives, and then you start seeing how many of them are infected. And the hope is that you will have much less infections in the vaccination group than in the group that they received the placebo. So this is the hope. And to do that, and to be certain, of course, you can see immunogenicity data, and you can see neutralization titles data, you can see all the data of the world, but you can only be certain if it works when you do this trial. And this is a trial that we hope to start in a few weeks, in July.
I mean, that's amazing. Tell us about the plans for the phase three trial. Are you running it just in the United States? Are you looking around the world as well?
We are looking around the world. I think the vast majority will be in the United States. The secret with that, it is to run the studies in sites that they are very experienced. So we are going to be not 5 or 10 research sites, right, will be on triple number, the number of sites that will engage, right? Will be more than 100, right, on the hundreds. So first of all, you need to make sure that all these sites, and when I say site for your viewers, I mean a hospital could be a site, right? We'll have hundreds of them. So we need to make sure that they are experienced, they have run studies before, because we want to make sure that no mistakes are avoided and things are moving according to the plan. Also, it is important that if you vaccinate, let's say, 30,000 people as we, in a trial, and there is no disease in the area that the people are living, it will take a long time until you will get enough infections to say that I have statistical difference between the placebo and my vaccinated group. So also it is important to select your sites in places that there is a lot of burden. This is burden right now. That will allow you to accumulate these events earlier. When I told you that we expect in the September timeframe, and you know, could be October, but this is how our calculations, we take some assumptions. We say, for example, that that would be the hit rate of the disease in the places that we are working, and we are taking the current CDC assumptions. So all of that played a role. We will have a global network of sites as Pfizer, because we have run this type of studies, for example, 30,000 people are not unfamiliar to us. It's very big studies. Not often you run studies with these numbers. But just to give you magnitude, we have run study for 80,000 people, 80 in our recent history, let's say 4 years ago. So we are very experienced with that. And we are going to use our global network.
So is it correct to plan, you know, 30,000 patients in the United States for a phase three? And then will there be additional outside the US? And just what can you tell us about the total numbers that will be involved in your phase three program and where outside the US?
Yeah, I think that we will be up to 30,000 people, approximately 30,000 people altogether. And that will be one study that will have multiple sites, I think predominantly in the US, but also in other parts of the world.
And how are the infection trends that we're seeing in the United States right now guiding which sites you're really engaging with? I mean, are you speaking most actively with places in Arizona, Florida, and Texas, given the infection rates there?
We will have sites across the country. And in our calculations about how quickly we will accumulate events, or let's say we will see people getting sick, we take into this consideration where we have the sites and what is the burden. Obviously, we are going to have sites, I said, all over the US, but in Florida, Arizona, Texas, obviously, there are places that certainly we will have sites.
Mm. We talked with Dr. Fauci about the safety risks of any vaccines, and in particular, the one we hear about theoretically, we haven't heard about this popping up in any of the early data, is this idea of antibody-dependent enhancement, that the vaccines could actually, by generating too weak of an immune response, actually make the disease worse when people encounter it. Have you seen any evidence of a risk of that in the early data?
No, we haven't seen, but this is something that we are going to monitor very, very closely. And also the fact that we are going to that large studies, so we will vaccinate thousands of people eventually with the vaccine, is something that gives us comfort level that if there are this type of side effects, we will catch them.
Mm-hmm. There's been some polling done about whether Americans would be likely to get a COVID-19 vaccine if one is developed. And the numbers are pretty low. In some cases, they seem lower than the number of adults who get flu vaccines every year. How does Pfizer look at this and the your industry peers who you talk with about what role the industry plays in trying to help the public feel more confident about getting vaccines?
I think the industry can play a significant role, but I think the more significant role should play scientists that they are outside of the industry and the authorities, the CDC, the NIH, Dr. Fauci, other prominent scientists, that they know the risks and the benefits that one can get from a vaccine. And they are obviously advocating significantly in favor of the vaccines. Because for us, I know that even if we say what we truly believe, that we will never put out there a vaccine that we don't feel ourselves, not FDA, ourselves, we will not even present it to FDA. If we don't feel that it is efficacious and safe, right, we might not be believed. But this is a problem because the decision, for example, not to vaccinate is not hurting only the individual, that at the end of the day, he could take the risk for himself or herself. But unfortunately, when it comes in pandemics, it hurts the society. Because we are creating the weak links that this virus needs to replicate. I know also that there will be a lot of political discussions. If, for example, are we cutting corners? And is FDA going to cut corners? Or is it going to be politically driven, the approval of a vaccine? I try to stay completely out of that. But I can assure everyone who is watching us that Pfizer will never cut corners. And Pfizer will never put out a vaccine, no matter who is pressing us, about that we don't feel ourselves to start with, our scientists, that it's safe and efficacious. But there will be a lot of that, unfortunately.
Yeah, so there was a New York Times op-ed just a couple weeks ago from Zeke Emanuel and Paul Offit, being a person who's developed some vaccines himself. And they said that they were worried about pressure on the FDA to approve a vaccine early before it's had the chance to prove that it can prevent disease based on immunogenicity data, just looking at the tests and showing that the vaccine produces antibodies. If Pfizer had the opportunity to get an emergency use authorization, that sort of early emergency approval from FDA based simply on that biomarker data, would Pfizer proceed with that before you've proven that the vaccine prevents disease?
I think for ourselves to be convinced that it is efficacious and safe, we need to have holistically to see multiple data. And as regards the FDA requirements, I don't want to speak for themselves. But what I know it is that they have made it very clear that they are not planning to cut corners. I'm sure that they are setting our standards and we are in constant discussion with them. And the standards that they are communicating to us as sponsors of vaccines are very, very high. And and by the way, I want to thank FDA in which sense that they respond extremely fast. This is what we need right now. We don't need them to reduce the standards. Actually, I think they should keep the standards high so that the people can believe when a vaccine is high that it went through, let's say, the test was high. But we want them to act fast. We want them to see what we send them and instead of 1 month to reply in 3 days. Not because they didn't read it well, but because they will put all the efforts and emphasis there. And they are doing it right now, so I'm grateful to them.
And of course, the the government program focused on vaccines is called Operation Warp Speed. So the speed is in the title. I understand that Pfizer is not taking funding from BARDA, for example. You are driving this all yourself and perhaps not participating in the government coordination of clinical trials in the United States. But is Pfizer working under Operation Warp Speed? What is your relationship like with the U.S. government on this?
Yes. Pfizer didn't take money, any money, for this vaccine from the U.S. government or from any other government in the world. It was not an easy decision to do, but we did it. And the reason why we did that it is because when you take money, the people that are giving the money want to know how you spend them and what exactly you are doing. And speed was of essence right now. So I wanted to make sure that we give to our people autonomy to move fast and run and being able to produce a vaccine, to develop a vaccine. As I have said to multiple people, and I think to you as well, our main goal was not return on investment when we started. The return on investment was a word that I sent an email at the beginning of the crisis to the members of my leadership team, should not be a consideration at all. So that's why you don't take money. A return on effort should be a great consideration, which means that what are the areas that if we put the effort, we can have results. And return on effort meant that if we take the money, we will be slowed down. So by maintaining our independence, I think we are moving much, much faster. Now, we are part of World Speed. We don't take money because we don't need money, right? We are not having, for example, NIH to run our studies, because we are a leading vaccine company. We have run multiple studies in our history. And right now, the COVID-19 is the seventh the seventh vaccine that we have in clinical studies. We have other six in clinical studies. So we didn't need the money, we didn't need the expertise, but there are other things that we may need from them. Maybe in the logistics, when we bring the vaccine, how to make sure that the vaccine will reach all vaccination points. So we are in very close contact with the Warp Speed, and we believe, and we are asking them things that they may help us, and they are very helpful, extremely helpful, I would say. But we don't need money. Maybe others need, or they don't want to give. And we don't need the expertise to run a study, because this is our core capability.
How is Pfizer making decisions about where to distribute the vaccine around the world? Are you getting orders from governments yet?
Well, I have to say that will be a hot potato. I hope that we will have a vaccine, and I hope that will be many. But yes, governments are reaching out, and they are discussing with us, and they want to place orders. And our idea is that to start with, knowing that there will be a conflict, we have created two separate manufacturing supply networks. A separate for the US, that it is in the US and will supply the US, and another one which is in Europe, separate from the US, and they will supply Europe. But of course, Europe and the US is not the whole world. We know that there are other countries, developed and under and developing countries. And those countries might not represent commercial opportunities like Africa, for example, but from human rights, they have equal rights to health. So it's going to be shortage in the beginning. The main way we try to overcome this is by making our production as high as possible, because that's the only way to be able to overcome. That's why I said before that we were thinking, and we spoke conservatively, we think in 21 we'll have hundreds of millions. Right now we are above billion that we can have in 21 of doses, if, again, I repeat, Meg, things goes according to plan and the stars continues to be aligned, which I'm very surprised that they continue to be right now. So that will be the best way. Also, there will be, we try to resolve by talking to different organizations, infrastructure issues in Africa, for example. A vaccine that needs at the beginning minus 80 degrees, it is something that in a developed world is very small logistical issue to be able to overcome. in Africa, I'm sure that few countries will have the infrastructure to be able to handle something like that. So we need either to develop this infrastructure or to develop, as we are doing right now in our second generation, vaccines that do not need that type of temperature. So a lot of efforts, Meg. Our scientists right now virtually don't sleep at night, and those people also during the day work, trying to resolve these issues, and our manufacturing people.
I can only imagine, and the world is grateful for the work that they're doing. How are you approaching the pricing of the vaccine, particularly in countries like the United States? Do you anticipate making a profit?
Yes, I think that the price of the vaccine was something that I never thought, because as I said, we never put calculations. This is how much it will cost us. This is how much we are going to make. We only put calculations. If we do that, we may save the world. And but then I started thinking about the price because all the governments of the world are calling us, and obviously they want to place orders and they want the price. And it's very difficult to think of a price in the traditional way, because if you try to price your vaccine based on the cost effectiveness, means that what will be the cost benefit to society because you are getting a vaccine, then you will go to astronomical numbers about how much you can price a vaccine and still be cost effective. That will be completely unethical. Even if you isolate completely how much you are going to save the global economy, but also you are focusing on the healthcare costs. For example, if someone vaccinates all the people of a country and pays that much, how many less hospitalization will have, and how much is the cost of these less hospitalizations, so that that should match the cost of the people that you vaccinate. That's a neutral cost to the healthcare system, right? Again, it's very, very high number. So the numbers that we are discussing with governments, because we cannot set the price based on the value, because obviously it's going to be very high, it is prices that already exist for other vaccines. And of course, during the pandemic, given the big volumes, we will try to provide discounts.
Discounts, but you do anticipate making a profit on the vaccine?
We do anticipate to make a profit on the vaccine.
I see. We're just about out of time. I had so many more questions for you, but I'll just ask you two more. One is, you mentioned your scientists are staying up all night. What's keeping you up at night right now? What is the problem that you're most wrestling with or you're worried you might encounter?
Yeah, I sleep very well at night. I sleep. I'm not like my scientists, but I know they don't. But I wake up, I would put it differently. I wake up very energized every morning, because I think that what we are doing here is noble. You just said, I am aware that right now, billions of people, millions of businesses, hundreds of governments are investing their hope for a solution to a handful of pharma companies. And we are one of the leading ones. So that puts a lot of weight on my shoulders. Because scientists are doing all the work, but at the end of the day, it's coming to management decisions based on the data that we have. Shall we go one direction or the other? And these are very difficult decisions. So I pray and I hope that I will make the right ones. And that's what is in my head.
Yeah, just a little pressure. And my last question for you is, if you had to put a probability of success on your efforts in this vaccine, where would you put it?
Higher than when we started, because I'm encouraged. I'm optimistic. And as I said, without speaking with numbers, I think it's more a question of when rather than a question of if we will have a vaccine.
All right. Albert Bourla, thank you for this discussion. And we look forward to hearing the updates and seeing the published results of your human trials, hopefully very soon. Thanks again, Albert.
Thank you very, very much, Beck.
All right. I'm going to toss it back over to Esther from Faster Curious. Esther, over to you.
Well, thank you so much, Meg. And once again, I'd like to thank Dr. Fauci and Dr. Bourla for their incredible insights, and our moderator, Meg, you did a fantastic job for guiding these conversations. We remain hopeful about the cautious optimism that both have expressed on vaccine development. I'd also like to thank everyone who joined us this week for the Milken Institute Summer Series. We're grateful for your support and your participation. Be sure to check our website for videos of this week's sessions. And finally, we look forward to you joining us this fall at the Milken Institute Global Conference. Be on the lookout for more information in the weeks to come. Again, thank you.